pleasant good morning, Christian friends. I greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It is indeed a blessing to be here in the presence of God and among you wonderful people. I now invite Gary, who will do an intro this morning, and it is titled, You Sing. Let us listen to Gary as he blesses his song.
Well,
thank you for filling this place with that wonderful song. You can really feel the Holy Spirit move. Let us all stand as we prepare our hearts and minds and we come together to worship God. Give praise to the Lord. Proclaim His name. Make known among the nations what He has done. Sing to Him. Sing praise to Him. Tell of all His wonderful acts. Glory in His name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and His strength. Seek His face always. Amen. Friends, I invite you now to join in a word of prayer. Let us pray. Most holy and ever-loving God, your name is great and greatly to be praised. We honor you and give you the praise and adoration that you deserve. Oh, how we magnify your precious name and worship you in spirit and in truth. Oh God, let our greatest delight be to love you and serve you. Let everything revolve around you and you alone. Be present at this hour of worship in such a way that we will be refashioned by the Holy Spirit in thought, heart, and mind. Lord Jesus, be the center of our lives, and let us rejoice in your glory. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Let us lift our voices in song as we sing from our multimedia. Opening hymn 321, for those who want to use the book of praise. And that song is Praise to the Lord Almighty.
Praise to the Lord.
again unite our hearts in the fellowship of prayer. Let us pray. God of mercy and of compassion, we come before you with penitent hearts, knowing that we have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. O Jesus, you know that our thoughts, words, action and deeds were not pure and righteous. Forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Purify us and make us holy. Grant us today your pardon for the sins of our lips, for unkind words, and for any action that may have hurt others. O loving Father, we know that we disobey you and lose our way in darkness and despair. Forgive us, Lord, for our shortcomings. O God, for we thank you for the assurance of pardon. Accept our thankfulness for all that you have done for us, and help us to be ever mindful of your love, goodness, and compassion. Father God, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life for us so that we may have everlasting life. We give you praise for every experience of happiness in our lives and homes. We thank you for the many blessings you daily give us, for your unfailing love and mercy. Lord, we praise you for the joy we experience when we gather to worship you. Thank you for your Lord Jesus Christ, who is the way, the truth, and the life. Bless and accept our prayers through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Redeemer. Amen. Every man shall give as he is able, according to the blessing of the Lord, your God, which he has given you. The morning's offering will now be received for the work and the witness of the church. During this time, we will sing and along with our musicians the song number 648, I'm going to lift so what can you use me.
Thank you.
present as a token of our love and devotion. Bless the hands that have so freely given. Sanctify these gifts, and may they be used for the furtherance of thy kingdom. This we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, with thanksgiving. Amen. Reading from Colossians chapter 1, verses 11 to 20. May you be strong. May it strong. strong with all the strength which comes from his glorious power, so that you may be able to endure everything with patience. And with joy, give thanks to the Father, who has made you fit to have your share of what God has reserved for his people in the kingdom of light. He rescued us from the power of darkness and brought us safe into the kingdom of his dear Son, by whom we are set free, that is, our sins are forgiven. Christ is the visible likeness of the invisible God. He is the firstborn superior to all created things. For through him God created everything in the heaven and on earth, the seen and the unseen things, including spiritual powers, lords, rulers, and authorities. God created the whole universe through him and for him. Christ existed before all things, and in union with all things have their proper place. He is the head of his body, the church. He is the source of the body's life. He is the firstborn son who was raised from death, in order that he alone might have the first place in all things. For it was by God's own decision that the Son has in himself the full nature of God. Through the Son, then, God decided to bring the whole universe back to himself. God made peace through his Son's blood on the cross, and so brought back to himself all things, both on earth and in heaven. This is the word of the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Ms. Lewis, for that powerful reading. I now invite Gary to bless us his song.
It's not always me.
Friends, I invite you to join me in a word of prayer. Let us pray. Holy and precious God, your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Let your word pierce our hearts that we may be transformed by your living word. Lord, silence any voice in us but your own, and Jesus be the center of this church. And now, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord. Amen. This morning's meditation will be focused on the theme, Jesus be the center of it all. Jesus Christ is to occupy all our thoughts this morning. Our focus should be on Him and Him alone. He should be the center of our lives, and all our thoughts, our actions, words, and deeds should always revolve around Him. Jesus be the center of it all. The words are few, but the meaning is vast. When the Apostle Paul said that the gospel was preached, he said, Christ is preached. For the gospel is Christ himself. Paul's letter to the Colossians was written to the church at Colossae, a town in Asia Minor. Paul had learned that there were false teachers in the church at Colossae, and he opposed their false teachings with true Christian message. The heart of his message is that Christ is able to give full salvation. Christ loved the church and gave himself for it, as we all know. Jesus gave his life on the cross so that we may have eternal life. Paul says he offered up himself. What can be greater than that? Now the main purpose of that letter, and you all know that Paul would have written this letter in prison. I didn't want to go too much into the history of it because of time. But the main purpose of this letter to the Colossians is to show the supremacy and sufficiency in Jesus Christ. The problem in Colossae is that there was a threat to the early church. So Paul wrote this letter. Paul's faith was so strong in the Lord, he wanted to convey that message through this letter to the people who were threatened at the time. And this threat was, at that time, to make Jesus less than God. But you, as we know, Jesus is God himself. So Paul, there were enemies in the church just trying to bring down the church. And you know, in our old Presbyterian church, churches throughout our nation, it happens at times. The enemy is there lurking, but we must stand guard. And Paul wrote this letter for that purpose, to guard the church and to show the position of God, to show his supremacy, to show that he created all things in heaven and in earth. He created you and he created me. So Paul wanted to let the people know, he wanted to make a point. So Tara, as we know, you were born, God created you. And what are we to do? We are to give God that praise, all that glory that he deserves. So that is part of the message this morning. We want to give God that glory. We didn't make ourselves. So as we continue to read Colossians, I just want to refer to Colossians 1 verse 18, that tells us that Christ is the head of his body, the church. He is the source of the body's life, as I just mentioned. He wanted to make a clear statement where Jesus was concerned, where he stood in our lives. And so when Paul was writing this letter to the church, he started expressing his prayer for the Colossian believers. Suddenly, in verses 15 to 20, he was so deep in prayer that he chanted a hymn of praise, quoting a worship song that was familiar to him. Let me pause here a bit. Have you ever been in such deep prayer that as a hymn, something just come into your being and you just start to sing it? You might be in some trouble. And you know, I remember once going to the dentist, and I have a fear for dentists. And I was like, you know, just sitting still and, you know, just buckling up. And I just started to sing, because around Christmas time, I remember singing Away in the Manger. And I didn't know after what the dentist did after that. You know, so sometimes when we are deep in prayer, and we are asking God for something, He removes all that fear. Right? So, as I continue, that song celebrates that Jesus is the center of all creation and the center of His body, the church. Jesus at the center of it all. It is a very specific song of response based on the truths expressed in Colossians. Let it also remind us that Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. We can ask the question, what areas of your heart does the song touch? Jesus, the center of it all. What do you mean if I say, make Jesus the center of my life? We may all have similar responses, but I hope that all of us will acknowledge Jesus as the ultimate authority on our lives, and you will voluntarily yield the control of your life to Him. For Jesus to be the center of your life, it means He is in control. You are no longer, and you no longer desire to independently run your own life as you well please. You know, some of us can do what we want, right? But we have to surrender all to Jesus. Surrender your whole self to Jesus and follow His lead. You must always abide in His presence. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Amen. Paul's words and attitude towards his ministry was to show the supremacy of Jesus, as I mentioned before. He wanted the church to know that Jesus was not just an ordinary person he knew from Galilee, but He was God Himself, the risen Creator, the Redeemer of the world. So friends, you see, it is pretty obvious the believers in the early church needed that extra push to speak, to express how awesome God was and how mighty He was. And He is. I should say is. Sometimes we also need that push to understand the feel of awesomeness of God. Right? So Paul also in that time, he wanted to motivate the church, motivate the people, so that they would also have that passion and love for worship and for God. How many of us here would have missed church during the COVID lockdown? And some of us are still missing church because they are unable to be here. I'm sure all of us. Because friends, you know, this is my experience. You crave to be in collective worship where you can hear the word, when you can hear, when you can be among the believers. It strengthens the church. So I know you must have seen many recordings and listened to it. It's not the same. You know, just actively listening and interacting with the minister and listening to the word and sharing also with your Christian believers and friends. As we read further in Colossians 1 verse 27, the Apostle Paul writes, God's plan is to make known His secret to His people, the rich and glorious secret which He has for all people. And the secret is that Christ is in you, which means that you will share in God's glory. So my friends, let us do our duty and preach Christ to everyone and reveal his greatness. And why would we want to reveal his greatness? So that we can win souls for his kingdom. Since Jesus is in control of our lives, then we must continue to preach the good news of what he has done for us. As mentioned in Colossians 1, verse 13-40, he rescued us from the power of darkness, our sins, that is the power of darkness. And he has brought us safe to the kingdom of his dear Son, by whom we are set free, by whom all our sins are forgiven. What a powerful lesson for all of us. Jesus freed us from darkness. He has forgiven us so many times for our errors. Isn't he just awesome and merciful? So Christian friends, let us continue to serve him faithfully and just dwell in his awesome presence. I just want to reflect here for a moment on a few questions. Are we Jesus-centered or are we self-centered? Do we falter at times? Do we shift gears from God-centeredness to self-centeredness? I am quite certain you have all the answers, but I would like to share some thoughts with you. Friends, to know God and to know God's will, we must turn away from self-centeredness. A self-centered life focuses on self. We are proud of what we have accomplished. A car, a good education, a house, many, probably more than one, and the list goes on. But where did we get those blessings? Where did it come from? It came from God above. Don't you agree? So to be Jesus-centered now, I would say, we have confidence in our all-powerful God, in his abilities and his provision for us, as we just mentioned. So then, let us walk together. Let us walk humbly, denying self, seeking first God's kingdom and his righteousness, and seeking God's perspectives in all circumstances. The heart of our worship should speak into the lives of others about the death and the resurrection of Jesus. We should make it known that everything around us is Jesus-centered and not self-centered. Our words and our actions should lead us to respond to the gracious love of God. And we must do this with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, and with all our strength. Through our songs of praise, our prayers, our worship, we can communicate like Paul and touch the lives of others so that they can make Jesus Christ their Lord and Savior. Now the Colossian hymn, that hymn should be the triumphant passport of Christians everywhere, celebrating Christ's greatness and more. What is our guarantee for eternal life? What is it? That we go to Jesus. Let him reside here. Let him stay here. Let him be the center of your life, your breath, the center of this church. Every breath you take, every step you make, every thought that comes your way, let it be from Jesus Christ, our role model, our guide, our teacher, our friend. Let us pattern our lives so we press on with joy and confidence, celebrating each victory in him. We are also to love every word of the Lord Jesus. You know, if we live by the word, we will be better and better. We become stronger and stronger in our faith, our Christian lives. So spend more time, you know, with the Bible, read it, try to internalize it, see what the words are really communicating to us. Secure yourself tightly to God and yoke yourself to Him. Set your love, set your affection upon Him. You know why? Jesus made everything. He made it all and He paid it all just for us. We must continue to just offer ourselves to Him. We have to respond to questions in life for which Jesus does not have specific answers. For example, when Paul writes, set your minds on things above, not on the things that are on earth. He makes it clear that you must set your minds on your affection on things that are above. The scripture expresses the priorities of God's kingdom precisely in the midst of our everyday earthly activities. How many of us hold on to what we have? Some of us hold on to our wealth. May not be you, I'm just saying. Some Christians. Car, jewelry, all sorts of things that we may consider. Maybe some of us may collect stamps, you want to hold on to that, coins, different things that are pleasures of the world. Hold on to it. Now during this time, the world is facing an economic crisis, as we all know. Stocks are falling, dividends are low, right? And when these things happen, I have read on the news, you see people committing suicide, right? Some of them get heart attack. I'm sure you follow the news and you have seen that, because you see stocks just started to drop. Now, I know none of us here, because we are believers, will do something like that, because we are not holding on to the earthly things. We are thinking about our treasures in heaven, right? So what some people really do suffer emotional stress because they hold on to many earthly things. Matthew 6, verse 21 tells us, for your heart will always be where your riches are. If you lose all your wealth, your treasures are greater in heaven. All the material things will vanish, but Jesus will always remain constant in your life. So you see, friends, heaven has to be our treasure, our peace of mind, and our joy. So let us center our heart's affection, our mind's attention, and our will to Jesus Christ, so that we can inherit all that He has promised. He must be the center of who we are and who we hope to be. If we do this, then we will live with Him in eternity. Jesus is Almighty God. He deserves our praise and devotion for all His goodness, His love, and His mercy for us. We must start with our purpose for being created, and that is to glorify the Lord in everything and to live in relationship with Him always. Let us then, friends, make Jesus the top priority of every aspect in our lives. Is Jesus the Lord of your thoughts, your actions, your reactions? Is Jesus the Lord of your relationships, your work life, and your free time? If these answers are yes, and we lapse, then now is the time to get it right. Today, we just want to glorify our Lord Jesus Christ. We want to praise Him with every fiber of our being. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. Let Him dwell in our hearts. Make Him the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus be the center of this church from the beginning to the end. It will always be. It's always been you, Jesus. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. one God. Amen. Let us join together in prayer. Loving God, creator of our lives and souls, we come before your holy presence, filled with the spirit of gratitude for every person gathered here today. Father God, bless us all in a special way and cover us with your mighty hands so that no evil or harm befall us. Bless our ministers and the church workers. We pray divine anointing upon them as they spread your word. Lord, create in us a generous spirit. Send your deep and mercy to feed and clothe the hungry. Lord, rid our land of crime, political strife, lawlessness, and just allow righteousness, peace, and harmony to prevail. We pray that your healing balm of Gilead will be on those who are afflicted by illness. Lord, you know every person's need at this time. We just lift up your people, and by the blood of Jesus we claim healing. Comfort with your presence those who are shattered by grief, by despair, and those who are lost of all alone, especially those abandoned children. Just watch over them. Oh God, we just want to lift up our principals, our administrators, teachers, the SEA students, or the educators and staff who are returning to school tomorrow. May your Holy Spirit be with them, protecting them from harm's way. Keep them healthy and safe. Lord, you just take control over everything because with you all things are possible. And we trust in your love and goodness. Help us to be sensitive to the needs of our brothers and sisters, and to speak a word of encouragement to lift their spirits. We ask these things in the name of our beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Let us join together to say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we that you would grow in us and strengthen us. Jesus, be the center of our lives and this church. And now may the love of God, the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest, remain, and abide with us now and forevermore.
Thank you. Harmony Corps, who accompanied me, and my brother on the drums, Rabino.
Thank you.
It's been a pleasure being here. It's all here for the Lord. And just remember, so we're going to do something good today, right? And you go there, we're going to tell someone you love them, we're going to show a kind medium.